What you are seeing is a stellar nursery, a complex of hydrogen gas surrounding a population of newly formed stars. These new stars are massive and blow fierce stellar winds, which blow a giant bubble in the gas. But toward the southern end of this region is a massive, newly forming star, 12 times the mass of our sun. And it is here that astronomers are catching a rare glimpse into the creation of a stellar giant. Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. Stars are huge spheres of hydrogen gas that shine due to the energy released from hydrogen fusing into helium in their cores. But that hydrogen gas has to come from somewhere, and that somewhere are giant molecular clouds found all throughout our galaxy. These clouds are in constant motion and collide with other clouds, or sometimes get buffeted by the shockwaves from nearby supernova explosions. But when these events happen, the clouds will start to collapse. As they do so, a center of mass is formed, and material from the cloud begins to spiral in on top of it. This central object starts to heat up, and it's called a protostar for this reason. This is star formation in a nutshell, or rather in a molecular cloud. But because the protostars are hidden deep inside the centers of these clouds, there's still much about the process of star formation that is hidden from our view. But by careful observation and by developing sophisticated computer models, astronomers over time have built up a pretty good understanding of what's going on as a star forms. As the rotating cloud collapses, it flattens into a disk surrounding the protostar. Matter falls from this disk onto the protostar in a process called accretion. That's a pretty simple model of how stars form, but astronomers quickly understood that there were some problems with this idea. As the rotating star acquires mass, it rotates faster and faster. If something isn't done, the star would eventually rotate so fast that it would literally rip itself apart before it was ever born. But as astronomers studied these newly forming stars, they noticed patches of turbulent nebulosity associated with them. It turns out that these blobs are formed by jets of highly collimated material that's being expelled from the protostar in a bipolar outflow. The jets then slam into the interstellar medium, exciting and ionizing in the process, causing them to glow. These objects were first studied in detail by George Herbig and Guillermo Haro, and so we call these objects Herbig-Haro objects in their honor. The jets are always bipolar, though sometimes we can only see just one of the two jets because the other is hidden behind a wall of gas and dust. By expelling mass in a jet, a protostar effectively dumps angular momentum, keeping it from spinning up too rapidly and thus able to continue to form. The actual specifics of how these jets are formed and launched is still not yet well understood. It has something to do with matter falling from the accretion disk and interacting with the rapidly rotating star's strong magnetic field. It seems that the rotating star and magnetic field act as a kind of giant turbine producing the jets in the process. But the specifics are still a little bit fuzzy. After all, these objects are still hidden deep inside their stellar cocoons. The jets are long, stretching from several hundred astronomical units to several light years. And we can even watch these jets evolve over time. Using the Hubble Space Telescope, for example, some Herbig-Haro objects were studied over a couple of decades. And we can see these jets moving out away from their stars. But as we look at these jets, it quickly becomes clear that they are clumpy. This tells us that star formation is not a smooth and continuous process, but is fitful and episodic, alternating between periods of accretion and jet formation. Most of what we know about how stars form come from studying low-mass stars like our Sun undergoing formation. And this is for two reasons. First, low-mass stars take a lot longer to form than high-mass stars. A star roughly the mass of our Sun can take up to 10 million years or so to form, whereas a star that is maybe 10 times the mass of our Sun can take as little as 100,000 years to form. Now, even 100,000 years is a long time, but understand that that means that for any given star that we see, there's less chance that we would have caught a high-mass star forming. Another problem is that high-mass stars are far less common than low-mass stars. So if you happen to catch a star in the act of forming, chances are it's going to be a low-mass star. But low-mass stars are generally fainter than high-mass stars, which means that we are limited to studying stars that are relatively close by in our galaxy. And our galaxy is rich in dust and also rich in heavy elements or metals. So not only do we have limited knowledge of how high-mass stars form, but we also have models that are based on stars forming in metal-rich environments like our galaxy. However, some recent work by Dr. Anna McLeod and her team is now shedding some light on the formation of high-mass stars. McLeod used the European Southern Observatory's Very Large Telescope to examine a star-forming region in the Large Magellanic Cloud, or LMC. This region is called LHA-120-N180b, or N180b for short. This is a complex of ionized hydrogen that is energized by the more than 50 massive stars that have recently formed within. These stars weigh anywhere from 10 to 15 times the mass of our sun. Their powerful winds blow a giant bubble more than 130 light years in diameter. At 160,000 light years distant, it's certainly farther away from us than most nearby star-forming regions, but not so far that we cannot resolve it with our largest telescopes. Not only that, but the galaxy is really low in dust. That means that there's far less junk to obscure our view of star formation. Even better, the LMC is relatively low in metals. That makes N180b a natural laboratory for studying high-mass stars and how they may have formed in the early universe. In the southern part of N180b is a massive star that's undergoing formation that is just ripe for study. We're going to find out what's been learned about this star so far, but first, I want to thank my Patreon supporters for their generous support. Patty Broussard, Neil from Crypto Cruising, Eric from Modern Day Tech, John Cannon, Garoth Balayan, Aaron Wilson, Jennifer Brozek, and I want to welcome my two new Patreons, Niels Christensen and Joe A. Walters. Thank you so much for your generous support. In the southern part of N180b lies a massive, newly forming star, some 12 times the mass of our sun. It's nestled at the top of a pillar of dense molecular hydrogen. Surrounding the protostar is its protostellar accretion disk. But perpendicular to this disk are blobs of material, the jet from this forming protostar. To characterize the jets, McLeod and her team analyzed the spectra of the central star and the lobes of material that were flowing outward along the jet. They found that the lobes in the top of the image were Doppler shifted toward bluer wavelengths, while the lobes in the bottom part of the image were Doppler shifted toward redder wavelengths. This tells us the orientation of the jet, with the top part of the jet moving toward us and the bottom jet moving away. Both jets are moving between 300 and 400 kilometers per second, or if you prefer, 671,000 to 895,000 miles per hour. Pretty fast. The top lobe is about 11 light years in length, while the bottom is about 21 light years long. They're also very highly collimated, less than a light year in diameter. Given their lengths and their velocities, it seems that these jets have been blasting for about 33,000 years. The star accretes about 1/100,000th the mass of the sun each year, while the jets expel about 3/1,000,000th of a solar mass per year. The rates at which this protostar is accreting and losing mass are relatively high. However, these rates decrease as the star ages. That tells us that this protostar is still relatively young. But perhaps the most remarkable thing about the study is that its findings are remarkably unremarkable. The length of time involved in the formation and launching of these jets is about 10,000 years. And that's the same length of time as required for jets in low-mass stars. So this tells us that although the overall duration of high-mass star formation is much shorter than for low-mass stars, the length of time for jets seems to remain fixed at 10,000 years. That is a really interesting finding. It tells us that star formation for high-mass stars is accelerated, but is fundamentally the same physical process as in low-mass star formation. With studies like these, we can learn a lot more about how stars formed and indeed how we came to be in the process. Now, if you'd like to see more star formation in nearby galaxies, check out this recent video about a new high-resolution image made by the Hubble Space Telescope of the Triangulum Galaxy. And if you would like to join me on this journey through this amazing universe of ours, well, please make sure to subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out on any new videos. Until next time, stay curious, my friends.